Good afternoon. Before we begin our Good Friday service, there's a few announcements. First of all, Father David and I will hear confessions immediately after our Good Friday service. I'll be in the confessional and Father David will be in front of the tabernacle, and you can go both anonymously or face to face to both of us. For the veneration of the cross, we will do it in the center aisle. So if you're on the sides, if you would just make your way through the pews to the center, form two lines and come down. And we're asking for veneration. You can either bow, genuflect, or touch the cross. We're asking not to kiss it. So bow, genuflect, or touch the cross during the veneration. And again, if you're on the sides, if you could just make your way into the center and come down the center aisle with everyone else. Also, there are baskets at the entrances of the church. It's a custom, we haven't done it in a while, that the Good Friday collection goes to support our Christian brothers and sisters in the Holy Land who are struggling at this time. So anything you can do to help them is greatly appreciated.
Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations, Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured, while we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of all of us. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off the land of the living, and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked, and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his sufferings, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, and he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Father, I put my life.
reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears for the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son, though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden, into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus, Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you're looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword in its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was the gatekeeper said to Peter, "You are not
one of this man's disciples, are you?"
He said, "Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret, I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They will know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said, Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him, He denied it and said, "One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear had been cut off, said, Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning. And they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him, At this Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute him."
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him, Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him, when he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Not this one, but Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged, and the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head, and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said, and they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak, and Pilate said to them,
"Behold, "Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law, we ought to die, because he is the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him, so Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you, and I have power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are not Caesar. Everyone who makes himself king opposes Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
They cried out,
"Take him away, take him away, crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but Caesar."
Then he handed him over to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests and the Jews said to Pilate, Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top down. So they said to one another, in order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots." This is what the soldiers did, standing by the cross of Jesus, were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine, so they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Now, since it was Preparation Day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day was that week, was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate for their legs to be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and this testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may become to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled: not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus, for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths, along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
My sisters and brothers in Christ, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
At sundown on Wednesday of this week, our Jewish sisters and brothers began the sacred time of Passover. There is a moment in the Jewish Passover meal, the ritual feast that marks the beginning of the Jewish holiday of Passover, when the youngest person present, usually a child, asks the question, why is this night different from all others? Why the unleavened bread, the bitter herbs? Why is this night different? The response to the question unfolds in the great story of the Exodus of the Jewish people from the bondage of slavery in Egypt to the freedom of life in the Promised Land through the power of God at work in their lives. For us as Christians, today's liturgy could easily prompt a similar question. Why is this day, Good Friday, different from all others? In response to the question, we could begin by saying that it is different because we focus our thoughts today quite singularly on Jesus' death on the cross, his exile, and the end of his earthly sojourn. In this midpoint of the great liturgy of the sacred Triduum, the word of God proclaimed during this moment reflects upon Jesus' rejection by many. His embrace of the sins of humankind and the suffering and pain that he experienced for the sake of a lost and broken world. With these thoughts, we can begin to understand why this day is different. But if the sole purpose of Good Friday is simply to remind us of the cross of Jesus, and by implication, the crosses that we carry. It would hardly seem that we need a special day to focus on such phenomena and the pain and suffering that accompanies them. Most of us are aware of crosses and struggle every day. Since last Good Friday, so many of you who join us today have been confronted by the death of someone you love, a death due to age, an unexpected illness, an accident, a death that has inflicted upon you and others the cross of pain and suffering that comes from grief and loss. Perhaps your cross has emerged from rejection, the rejection of a child, a friend, or a spouse. Maybe it has emerged because of illness, your own, or that of someone you love. Maybe it emerged as a result of unemployment and a concern for the well-being of your family. Maybe it emerged because of a value that you hold as a Christian that you are unwilling to change or compromise. The reality of life is that suffering is all around us. We don't need a day to remind us of it. We are familiar with our crosses all too well. Perhaps then, the most significant question that we should ask is not why Good Friday is different from other days, but instead, ask what meaning does this day have for me and for you? First and foremost, Good Friday situates Jesus in the very midst of our suffering. Pope Benedict XVI, in his book, Jesus of Nazareth, acknowledged that fact. He said, quote, "The reality of evil and injustice that disfigures the world and at the same time distorts the image of God, this reality exists through our sin. It cannot simply be ignored, it must be addressed. And God himself becomes the locus of reconciliation in the person of his Son, takes the suffering upon himself. God himself drinks the cup of every horror to the dregs and thereby restores justice through the greatness of his love, which through suffering transforms our darkness." Close quotes. Simply put, Good Friday reminds us that Jesus is bound up with all the suffering of human history. The suffering that comes as a result of the brokenness of our world. The suffering that we experience in fragile bodies that wither away. The suffering of loneliness and isolation. And the suffering that emerges in our lives due to our sin and poor choices that we make each day. The choices that break relationships and wound our hearts. Jesus is bound up with all of our suffering. Yet, quite honestly, sometimes it's so hard, such a challenge to believe without question that God is present to us as we carry our crosses. If only God would speak a word of consolation. If only I could hear him. It would be so much easier to carry this cross. If we listen carefully enough to the words of the Passion, we would discover just how intimately Jesus is woven into our struggles, even those that do not cause us to wonder if God might very well have abandoned us in our moment of pain and desperation. Once again, I share with you the words of Pope Benedict XVI. this time from his exhortation, Verbum Domini. Quote, "The silence of God, the experience of the distance of the Almighty Father from our conscience, is a decisive stage in the earthly journey of the Son of God, the incarnate Word. Hanging from the wood of the cross, Jesus lamented the suffering caused by that silence. My God, why have you forsaken me? Yet, advancing in obedience to his very last breath, Jesus called upon the Father. He commanded him to himself at the very moment of the passage through death to eternal life. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Jesus' cross didn't spare him from physical pain or the pain that comes from wondering why his Father remained so silent in his moment of need. It did, however, carry him to the resurrection and eternal life. The cross carried Jesus to life because in spite of his suffering and in spite of the silence, he clung to a relationship with his Father and proclaimed that relationship even to the end. Therein is the meaning and the lesson of Good Friday for you and for me. Even in the midst of desperate pain and suffering, even in the face of loneliness and what seems like abandonment, the promise of God manifested definitively in the death and resurrection of Jesus is that he will not let go of us, but will carry us to life and peace. For our part, we have only to cling to our relationship with the Lord and echo those words of Jesus as he hung from the cross. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. The openness to God in faith, expressed so powerfully in the words of Jesus, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit," is all we need to express the experience, the healing and hope of Good Friday, and to give meaning and peace to our broken world. Those words reflected in lives that are authentically open to God becomes the means by which we encounter the powerful healing of Good Friday. And why is it so simple to exchange with God all we need? Because we did not choose him, he chose us. Just as he chose the people of Israel, he chose us to be his sons and daughters. And we remember this day other words of Jesus, also from the Gospel of St. John. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend. That, my sisters and brothers, is the heart of Good Friday, and that means through which we find our salvation.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty. Almighty and ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout all the world may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed in the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God. Almighty, ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord. Let us pray also for our Bishop Lawrence, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, and for the whole of the faithful people. Almighty, ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our catechumens, that our God and Lord may be open wide the ears of their inmost hearts, and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received the forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord. Almighty, ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one church. Almighty, ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Almighty, ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that, enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Almighty, ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love, and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right with sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Almighty, ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you, and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love, and in the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to his will, for the true peace and freedom of all.
Almighty, ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those you govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, salvation to the dying.
Almighty, ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in the hour of need your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray for the people in Ukraine, the Middle East, in all war zones of the world, for those who have fled the dread of violence and have been deprived of their homes, for all women and men who stand up with their lives to ward off evil and to protect the weak and persecuted.
Almighty, ever-living God, you have compassion for the lowly and the poor, but you cast down oppressors.
As you guided Israel out of slavery in Egypt, so in our days save all victims of war and violence. Change the hearts of evildoers, and let peace be victorious through Christ our Lord.
Hung the salvation of the world. Hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us
hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
As the Savior commanded, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have life unceasingly devoted to you through Christ our Lord. May abundant blessings, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure through Christ our Lord.